Hello friends, welcome to Knowledge Galaxy to rediscover the basics with Mayank Tiwari, a premier coaching and training channel dedicated to metallurgy studies and consultancy, established to cater the needs of students, degree, diploma and AMIIM metallurgy, competitive and recruitment exams for GATE, SAIL and various other government and private sector companies, metallurgical industries and whosoever seeking knowledge and information about various subjects and topics of metallurgy, operational process optimization, productivity improvement analysis, concepts like 5S, total productive maintenance, TPM, quality circle, QC, root cause analysis, RCA, ISO systems, QMS, EMS and OSHAs, practical and effective communication English written and spoken. My dear friends, this video is very much important to impart practical industrial knowledge as per your specific requirements via tailor-made training sessions for your colleagues, employees and students. Please contact me on knowledgegalaxy26@gmail.com or WhatsApp me on +91 99 071 44 101 for scheduling and organizing the sessions at your place or via video conferencing. My dear friends, today I am going to discuss details about production of ferromanganese. Since ferromanganese is the major contributor of ferroalloys, which are commonly known as bulk ferroalloys, and ferromanganese is very important for the production of steel. So I request you to please do watch the video till the end, as at the end you will get the burden calculation or material balance, which is very much important to know about. Please do watch the video till the end, and I hope you will like the content. So let's start. Production of carbon bearing ferromanganese. The production of carbon bearing ferromanganese is a continuous slagging process. The oxides of iron, manganese, silicon, phosphorus, etc. contained in the ore are reduced by coke carbon in smelting carbon bearing ferromanganese in electric furnaces. The reduction of these oxides is attended by the evolution of gases at the furnace top. Higher oxides of manganese ores introduced into the furnace decompose with the evolution of oxygen at low temperature of 430 degrees Celsius. 4MnO2, this gives 2Mn2O3 plus O2. While manganese oxide decomposes at 950 degrees Celsius according to the reaction, 6Mn2O3, this gives 4Mn3O4 plus O2. Mn3O4 is reduced by carbon monoxide to MnO by the reaction. Mn3O4 plus CO is equal to 3MnO plus CO2. Consequently, manganese ore reaches the high temperature zone as MnO. The reduction of MnO by fixed carbon proceeds at about 1430 degrees Celsius as per the reaction. MnO plus C is equal to Mn plus CO. At lower temperatures, the reduction of MnO may be accompanied by the formation of Mn3C as per the reaction. 3MnO plus 4C is equal to Mn3C plus 3CO. Mn3C obtained is reverted to the alloy as its melting point is approximately 1250 degrees Celsius. At these temperatures, the conditions for the reduction of SiO2 contained in the manganese ores are unfavorable, and a considerable portion of it reverts to the slag along with the oxides of aluminium, calcium and magnesium. Silicates MnO.SiO2 and 2Mn.SiO2 generated in the furnace revert to the slag and hamper the reduction of MnO. A flux line or boromite is added to the mixture to cut manganese-like losses. In this case, MnO is free from the silicates as per the reaction. MnO.SiO2 plus CaO.MgO is equal to CaO.MgO whole SiO2 plus MnO. MnO.SiO2 plus 2CaO.MgO is equal to 2CaO.MgO.SiO2 plus MnO and may be reduced by carbon. When smelting carbon-bearing ferromanganese, phosphorus pentoxide P2O5 is readily reduced and reverts to the alloy, thus sharply worsening the ferromanganese quality. About 65-70% of ore phosphorus is recovered in the alloy. Main reactions at various temperature zones in the production of ferromanganese and silicomanganese are as follows. My dear friends, this knowledge I have gained over my 20 years of experience, which includes industrial practical experience of furnace operation and other important areas. So please do watch and do like the channel. So let's continue. First, temperature range is 430 degrees Celsius to 1430 degrees Celsius. First reaction that occurs is Fe2O3 plus 3C. This gives 2FeO plus 3CO. Subsequently, 2FeO plus 3CO is equal to 2Fe plus 3CO2. Second reaction occurs is MnO2. This then gives to Mn2O3. This decomposes to Mn3O4. And finally, it reaches to as MnO. MnO plus C is equal to Mn plus CO. Third reaction is SiO2 plus 2C. This gives Si plus 2CO. Other reaction is P2O5 plus 5C is equal to 2P plus 5CO. Carbon-bearing ferromanganese is manufactured by a flux-free method in order to obtain rich slag with low phos content. The advantages of the flux-free method are as follows. Slags of the flux-free method of smelting or smelting are more fluid than those of fluxed heats. The amount of waste gases drops with the flux-free method. Production of carbon-bearing ferromanganese without the use of fluxes permits appreciably to increase furnace productivity and to lower specific power consumption from 3600 kWh to 2600 to 2800 kWh per ton of ferrola is produced. Subsequent use of rich slag permits to attain an overall manganese recovery of 81-83% instead of 80% as in the case of fluxing method. Slags obtained through the flux-free method of smelting carbon-bearing ferromanganese carry a considerable amount of manganese, that is 38-42%, and negligible amount of phosphorus, that is 0.015-0.030%, thus permitting to use them as metallurgical raw materials instead of manganese ores in the smelting of low-carbon manganese alloys. Advantages of MnO slag over manganese ores. My dear friends, this is very much important topic as you might have to consider and should have to consider MnO slag over manganese ores because of various reasons which are described as follows. The slag possesses a number of advantages over manganese ores. First is, manganese occurs in the ore in the form of MnO2, while in the slag it is in the form of MnO. This makes it possible to use lesser amount of reducers. Second, low phos content in the slag, that is 0.015-0.030% against 0.14-0.18% and more in the ore, ensures a sharp decrease in phos content in the alloys produced from slag. When carbon-bearing ferromanganese is smelted by the flux-free method, the mixture is composed of manganese ore, metallurgical fine coke and iron chips. Carbon-bearing ferromanganese is smelted with a secondary voltage of 110 to 140 volts and a current density of 4 to 5.5 amperes per square centimeter. This ensures lower manganese evaporation losses from localized hot spots. Furnaces smelting carbon-bearing ferromanganese are lined like those smelting ferrosilicon. Now let us discuss some abnormal conditions and their troubleshooting, which are very much important from the operational point of view and maintaining a good furnace health and good productivity of the furnace. The descent of the charge has a serious effect on the smelting procedure. Therefore, it is necessary to ensure a uniform burden movement over the whole furnace area. This is achieved by timely racking of the charge burden onto the electrodes. For better furnace operation and adequate charge mixing, coke is weighed first, manganese ore second, and then iron chips and fluxes. My dear friends, you might consider this as very important, as it is very important from the point of view of starting the furnace operation, that which material is to be weighed first and which to later. So please do take care of this. As soon as the mixture sinks close to the electrodes, new portions of the materials are fed to the furnace. The mixture is conveyed from furnace bins through tubes onto the furnace top. After that, the mixture is heaped around the electrodes by racking in the form of cones rising 300 to 400 mm above the furnace top level and up to just below the contact clamps or pads. Normal furnace operation is characterized by the presence of constant charge zone cones around all electrodes. Following are the benefits of racking the charge materials around the electrodes. It ensures uniform evolution of gases over the entire charge surface. Deep and stable positioning of electrodes inside the charge burden means optimum penetration. Collapse-free burden descent means smooth movement of the burden inside the furnace. Maintaining proper permeability in the charge burden inside the furnace enables consistent and hassle-free evolution of gases, resulting in uniform and effectively improved contact of reducing gases with the charge mix, thereby improving the reduction of the charge materials, which in turn results in correspondence of the alloy and slag contents to the burden calculations. Breaks and reduces the formation of bridges, scaffoldings, etc. in the charge mix inside the furnace, thereby increasing the effective reaction crucible volume and improving the furnace productivity. Facilitates properly interconnected reaction crucibles of all electrodes, which results in easy tapping and better recovery of alloy and slag. Heat losses are minimized by properly covered electrodes and heat is effectively utilized. The charge materials prevent the atmospheric air from contacting the hot electrodes, which will get them eroded if exposed to air and eventually resulting in electrode breakage. If the furnace works normally, the charge materials reaches the high temperature zone well prepared and heated. When the charge hangs onto the electrodes, there is a possibility of collapses with subsequent ejection of red hot mixture and slag. High temperature blowouts about 1000 degrees Celsius, which occur simultaneously, may cause the considerable manganese evaporation and breakdown of mechanical and electrical equipments, damage to the furnace linings, surroundings that could be fatal also. So my dear friends, you have to be very careful while working and operating the furnace. Therefore, the sintered sections of the furnace top should be poked by iron rabblers or poles, while the mixture hanging on to the electrodes should be pushed down. Deviation from normal furnace operation may be caused by lag or excess of reducing agent in the charge mixture. In the former case, the alloy has low manganese and silicon and high phos content. The electrode's penetration is excessively deep. Power input at the electrodes fluctuates. Manganese losses in the slag increases. Furnace productivity falls and specific power consumption rises. Lack of reducers may lead to the damage of furnace linings, especially in the tap hole zone. When a furnace operates with an excess of reducer, heat losses rise, for the electrodes are shallow and evaporation of manganese increases. The silicon content in the alloy goes up. The currents in the electrodes are on the higher side, making it very difficult for the furnace operator to maintain proper load in the furnace. The abnormal conditions in the furnace emerges because of the disturbance in the slag chemistry, electrodes penetration and or water leakages inside the furnace. The remedy also varies depending on the actual cause of the problem. The slag chemistry gets disturbed because of the following reasons. MnO content in the slag goes beyond the range of 30 to 39%. In case the MnO content falls below 30%, the slag becomes viscous and results in improper drainage and causing imbalance in electrode current. If MnO content goes above 40%, the slag becomes extremely fluid and electrodes current falls. Electrodes penetration is very deep and damage to the furnace lining is more severe. Low MnO is mainly due to either high carbon or low manganese input from the raw materials. High MnO is mainly due to either high manganese and low carbon input in the raw materials. SiO2 content in the slag should be ideally around 22 to 30%, and the basicity should be between 0.55 to 0.58. If the SiO2 content in the slag comes below 22%, the slag becomes very fluid and highly basic, causing severe damage to the refractory linings. On the other hand, when the SiO2 content of the slag exceeds 30%, the slag becomes very high melting, viscous and basicity reduces. Its content in the ore blend should be in the range of 5 to 6.5%. Al2O3 content also plays a vital role in the slag chemistry and it should be in the range of 14 to 20% max. If it crosses about 20%, the slag becomes very high melting and doesn't flow out of the furnace. Its content in the ore blend should be in the range of 4 to 4.5%. By using quartzite in every 3 months, MnO content of the slag is intentionally increased to 38 to 39% to flush out the high melting slag or pseudo lining inside the furnace. Keeping high MnO in slag should be continued for 15 days. It helps in increasing the reaction crucible volume by melting slag or pseudo lining inside the furnace, thereby increases the furnace productivity. This type of correction is to be taken when high current condition in the furnace is observed continuously and recovery of the metal and slag has reduced. To set the furnace right, raw materials proportioning, that is burden calculation, and the size of the reducers should be checked. Additionally, amount of reducers charged and if necessary, coke weight per charge portion may be increased. In this case, the size and weighing accuracy of coke should also be checked and extra manganese ore should, if necessary, be charged onto the electrodes. In all cases of furnace trouble, technological procedures at the furnace top should be intensified. In the production of carbon-bearing ferromanganese, slag and metal are tapped out simultaneously through the same tap hole 4 to 5 times per shift. The liquid metal and slag are separated by the skimmer dam block arrangement, where liquid metal and slag gets separated from each other due to specific gravity difference. My dear friends, I have made a detailed separate video for the liquid metal tapping and separation procedures followed by various industries, various companies. Do watch in my channel. It is available in my channel. Please do watch that video also. In many places, the liquid metal and slag are tapped in the cast iron molds, where the liquid metal solidifies in the mold itself and the slag overflows to the sand beds for solidification. The tap hole is cleared of slag following the tapping and is then packed closed as much as possible with clay mixed with tamping paste burrs. An alloy and slag sample is taken to examine the quality and grade of the alloy and slag produced, and it is analyzed for manganese, silicon, sulfur and phosphorus contents in the alloy and oxides and basicity in the slag. After solidification, but prior to getting too cold, the metal and slag cakes are sent to the finished products yard with the help of EOP cranes for further breaking, sizing, packing and delivery to the customers as per their requirements. Now let us discuss something about standard grades of products. First discuss ferromanganese domestic grade, and then we will discuss about ferromanganese export grade. This is universally accepted and used grades, standard grades all across the world. For domestic grades, ferromanganese content is 70 to 75%. For export grade, manganese content is 75 to 80%. Iron content is 20 to 22% for domestic grade and 15% for export grade. Silicon content is 1.5% max in both the cases. Phosphorus content is 0.350% max for domestic and 0.30% max for the export grade. Carbon is same to 6 to 8% for both the cases. Now let us consider about the grades, standard grades of silicomanganese for both domestic and export market. Manganese content for domestic grade is 60 to 65%, and for export grade it is 65 to 70%. Iron content is 20 to 22% for domestic, and export grade it is around 15%. Silicon content is 14 to 15%, and silicon content is 16% for export grade minimum. Phosphorus content is 0.350% max for domestic grade, and for export grade it is 0.30% max. Carbon content is 2 to 3.5% for domestic grade silicomanganese, and for export grade silicomanganese it is also 2 to 3.5%. Furnace crews should concentrate on bringing down per ton losses of manganese and specific power consumption, as the raw materials and power are the highest cost items in the production of carbon-bearing ferromanganese. It is possible to improve operating results in high carbon ferromanganese smelting by using closed top electric furnaces, which bring down the cost price of the alloy and improve the working conditions for the furnace operators. So, my dear friends, now I am going to start the very interesting and very useful, very required part of the presentation, and that is burden calculation or material balance. Here I will discuss about the burden calculation for example of 1 ton of ferromanganese produced. So please do watch it very seriously, so that you can get the best out of it, and do repeat it and practice it so that you master it very easily. So let's start. Following steps are adopted for the burden calculation or material balance. It starts with taking the final product specifications and raw materials specifications and reverse calculation of the required manganese reductants and flux quantities for the production of 1 metric ton of alloy. Let's consider the product specifications as manganese 70%, carbon 8%, silicon 1.5%, phosphorus 0.4%, sulfur 0.03% and iron 0.20%. Let us consider the raw material specifications as manganese 44%, iron 6.4%, phosphorus 0.2%, SiO2 13%, Al2O3 3.10%, CaO 0.56%, MgO 1.21% and moisture 8%. This is a standard grade of raw materials which is normally used. It can change, so please do keep track of the raw materials specifications while taking the burden calculations. The reducer fine coke contains 75% fixed carbon. Dolomite containing 50% CaO plus MgO serves as flux. Let us consider the recovery of each element as follows. In metal, manganese 73%, iron 97%, silicon 6%, phosphorus 70%, sulfur 8% and carbon 18%. In slag, manganese 21%, iron 3%, silicon 91%, phosphorus 30%. Gas loss, manganese 6%, silicon 3%, sulfur 92% and carbon 82%. The amount of fixed carbon in the mixture exceeds the stoichiometric amount by 25%. Required manganese ore for 1 metric ton of alloy is 700 divided by 0.44 into 0.73 into 0.92 is equal to 2369 kg of dry ore. I repeat, 700 divided by 0.44 into 0.73 into 0.92 is equal to 2369 kg of dry ore. Here in this equation, let me explain. 700 is the quantity of manganese in 1 ton of alloy considering 70%, so it comes to 700, and 0.44 is the quantity of manganese percent in the 44% manganese in the ore, 73% is the recovery and 0.92 is the dry weight, means deducting the 8% moisture. So it comes to around 2369 kg of dry ore. Please do keep these things very seriously. Keep in mind always. Next, taking 2% handling losses, it comes to around 2369 into 102% is equal to 2416 kg of dry ore. Please, I repeat, taking 2% handling losses, 2369 into 102% is equal to 2416 kg of dry ore. Amount of manganese reduced by the reaction, MnO plus C is equal to Mn plus CO. So this comes to 2416 into 0.44 into 0.73 into 55 divided by 71 is equal to 601 kg. My dear friends, to master this equation and material balance, you have to always keep in mind the atomic weight and the equation equilibrium so that you can get the best out of this equation and do not make any mistake. So, amount of iron reduced by the reaction FeO plus C is equal to Fe plus CO. So it comes to around 2416 into 0.064 into 0.97 into 56 divided by 72 is equal to 217 kg. Manganese and iron total is equal to 601 plus 117 is equal to 718 kg. The manganese and iron contained in the alloy, the sum of carbon and silicon is subtracted, averages 100 minus 8 plus 1.5 is equal to 90.5%. The amount of alloy obtained is equal to 718 divided by 0.905 is equal to 793 kg. The amount of silicon in it is equal to 793 into 0.015 is equal to 12 kg. The amount of carbon necessary for the reduction of MnO according to the reaction, MnO plus C is equal to Mn plus CO. It comes to around 601 into 12 divided by 55 is equal to 131 kg. For the reduction of FeO according to the reaction, FeO plus C is equal to Fe plus CO. It comes around 117 into 12 plus divided by 56 is equal to 25 kg. For the reduction of SiO2 according to the reaction, SiO2 plus 2C is equal to Si plus 2CO. It comes around 12 into 24 divided by 28 is equal to 10 kg. For the carbonization of the alloy, 793 into 0.08 is equal to 63 kg. Total amount of carbon necessary is equal to 131 plus 25 plus 10 plus 63 is equal to 229 kg. My dear friends, please do note that this is the amount of fixed carbon, not the coke. So do keep in mind. Amount of fine coke necessary including 25% excess is equal to 229 into 1.25 divided by 0.75. It comes around 382 kg. My dear friends, please do not get confused since these two quantities are different. The first one, that is 229 kg, is the fixed carbon content, and this new quantity, that is 382 kg, is the coke, fine coke contained quantity required for the production of 1 metric ton of ferromanganese. I hope you are keeping in mind. Do watch it very seriously and always keep in mind. Let us calculate the necessary amount of dolomite, X being the amount of dolomite. So let us calculate. Introduced with the ore, SiO2 2416 into 0.13 minus 12 into 60 divided by 28 is equal to 288 kg. Al2O3 2416 into 0.031 is equal to 75 kg. MgO 2416 into 0.0121 is equal to 29 kg. CaO 2416 into 0.0056 is equal to 14 kg. My dear friends, these quantities of like 0.13, 0.031, 0.0121, 0.0056 respectively are the percentage of respective material in the ore. So please don't get confused. Total CaO plus MgO is equal to 43 plus 0.5 into X kg. SiO2 plus Al2O3 plus CaO plus MgO is equal to 288 plus 75 plus 43 plus 0.5X is equal to 363 plus 43 plus 0.5x is equal to 406 plus 0.5x kg. 43 plus 0.5x is equal to 0.2 into 406 plus 0.5x. 43 plus 0.5x is equal to 0.2 into 406 plus 0.2 into 0.5x. So x is equal to 0.2 into 406 minus 43 divided by 0.5 minus 0.2 into 0.5 is equal to 38.2 divided by 0.4 is equal to 95.5 kg. Thus, the composition of mixture for the smelting of 1 metric ton of ferromanganese will be as follows. My dear friends, now comes the $1 million question, which is very much important. Please do read and watch this very carefully and do keep in mind always. Magnesium 2416 kg, fine coke 382 kg and dolomite 95.5 kg. My dear friends, always keep in mind that this is the quantity of dry ore, coke and dolomite. Please do not confuse with weight quantities and always try to remove the moisture content to calculate or add the moisture content to calculate. My dear friends, I hope you might have liked the content because this is my 20 years hard earned knowledge and practical experience which I have earned, which I have shared with you all. Please do watch. My dear friends, I hope you liked the content and found the video worth. So please don't forget to like, share and subscribe the channel. Also remember to press the bell icon so that you can get the notification of the new videos promptly. My dear friends, I hope you like my content. Please do visit my channel regularly and please do watch all videos of my channel so that you can get the best knowledge from which I am sharing with you all. My dear friends, thank you very much for watching. Do visit my channel repeatedly. Like, subscribe and share. Thank you very much.